Yo, I'm sorting through some heinous haters like a Poopa Scooper. I'm Jada's trying to take my life like a Koopa Troopa. I'm double Mario, that mean I'm super super. And I'm freaking dangerous like a Chupa Chupa Cabre. Got him all day like a Kanye, but I'm way better. Getting cheddar in Monterey, but Jack, you don't know, man. You got a show, man. You want roast beef? Well, I'm Arby's.
What's up, my wizards? Dev, SBMTG down there. We do magic stuff on YouTube. How was your pre-release? Gotta ask that. Hope you won some packs, had some fun playing with shadows, you know? That's out of the way. Here's what I've been working on for the last week or so. It looks pretty good to me. This is Mardu Reanimator. We got a lot of tricks up our sleeves and a lot of interesting synergies, so I'm gonna go ahead and dive into it, because I've been having a lot of fun with this and I can't wait to tell you guys. Well, let's start with the creatures. As usual, there's 10 of them in the deck, and we'll start with four whole entire copies of Sin Prodder. The thing is a ridiculous boss in the deck. The thing has been really, really good for me. They're damned if they do and damned if they don't, regardless of what they do with their decision, because if they drop stuff in the graveyard, we want that. We have multiple ways of, you know, reanimating creatures. We have ways of getting things back from the graveyard that aren't creatures, or at least recasting things from the graveyard that aren't creatures with Goblin Dark Dwellers. So if they put things in the graveyard, we have Kolaghan's Command to get creatures back without necessarily reanimating them. So we've got a lot of ways of getting things back from the graveyard or recasting them. So if they put things in our graveyard, we're totally fine with that, and they'll take some damage along the way. We have huge guys in the deck. We have like Chandra and a bunch of like reanimation targets too. So we've got a lot of things that cost a lot of mana. They're going to want to let us have those cards rather than take five or six, you know. And if we happen to get an Ulamog off of it, they're probably going to let us have that. And if we want to reanimate the Ulamog, we can just use one of our discard outlets, throw it in the graveyard, reanimate it later. So what I'm saying here is that if they do stick something huge like an Ulamog in your hand that you can't cast right away, you have ways of getting rid of it and putting it in the graveyard so that you can then reanimate it for much cheaper. So Sin Prodder has been amazing. You either draw a card or you get something for reanimation or recasting later. Not only that, 3-2 Menace Body ain't half bad either. So Sin Prodder is actually a key piece in the deck. Two copies of Goblin Dark Dwellers in the deck works pretty well in this, especially with Sin Prodder. Especially if you draw it with Sin Prodder during your upkeep, they're going to want you to have it so they don't take five, you know. And then you play the Dark Dwellers and you get to recast something that they didn't let you have earlier in the game, or something you've already cast, you know. Maybe something you've discarded to a discard outlet. Lots of reasons to play Dark Dwellers. We have something like 11 different targets that this can hit out of the graveyard. So, yes, you know, another Menace Body, by the way. And sometimes you have a Sin Prodder and a Goblin Dark Dwellers, and like, they have to have four creatures to block both guys. That doesn't happen every day. So these guys are, Sin Prodder and Goblin Dark Dwellers, actually a really good team. So I wish you could play them on curve, you know, but if Dark Dwellers cost four, it'd be more or less completely broken. But these cards are really good together. That's all I want to point out, you know. But Dark Dwellers is good for other reasons. You know, like I said, 11 targets that it can hit. And it's really good with Nahiri, because sometimes with Nahiri's ultimate, you'll just search this up, recast something, swing in, pop it back to your hand, play it the next turn, and recast something else. That's ridiculous value. So Dark Dwellers, I feel like, absolutely has to be in the deck, and I might encourage a three of. Let's get into our reanimation targets here. We're playing one copy of Dragon Lord Kolaghan. Really have liked Kolaghan, actually. Not only because it's nice to have a reanimation target that flies and has haste. Haste, very important. But also gives our other creatures haste. So, like, if we can either hard cast or reanimate a Kolaghan, that means if we play an Ulamog, that sucker has haste, which is freaking ridiculous. So, Kolaghan's been good for lots of reasons, too. He seems pretty good. I haven't tested, but he seems pretty good against the upcoming Blue-Black Zombies deck, you know. He seems good against Prized Amalgam and Relentless Dead, you know. So that seems like a plus right there. Not only that, but, like, interesting against a lot of, like, aggro and mid-range decks in the format that play four of creatures, you know. And Jace, even a lot of people play four-up Jace, so if they try to cast a Jace while one's in the graveyard, that's 10. You know, really deters them from casting a Jace. If you've already killed one. So, have liked Kolaghan for a lot of different reasons. Just huge flying hasty body that gives your other dudes haste and deters them from casting stuff. So, yeah, great reanimation target. I'm just playing the one-of copy of Linvala the Preserver in the main deck. This has been a really good card just to have a one-of lying around, you know. Especially against aggro. We're going to take some damage early game, and we're running 8 pain lands. And, on top of that, we're running Anguished Unmaking, at least a one-of copy. So we're taking some damage and we're losing some life in this deck. And it's nice to have Linvala because you can more or less guarantee that by the time you, you know, reanimate this, that you can gain the 5. You know, you can get the guy too, because we're not running but 10 creatures. So you can get the creature pretty easily too. And if you can Necromantic Summons this into play with Spell Mastery, what you're looking at is a 7-7 flyer and a 3-3 flyer that gains you 5 life when it comes into play. Great reanimation target. And to finish it off, two copies of Ulamog. Ulamog, not only good to reanimate out of your graveyard, and I do want to note that you won't get the cast trigger. You won't get to exile two things. But what you will have is a 10-10 indestructible that mills a third of the library when it swings in. Even if you have to wait a turn on that, seems pretty fine, honestly. And keep in mind, if you have a Kolaghan out, this thing can swing haste, which is dumb. Also, crazy with Nahiri, if you can ultimate Nahiri, which actually isn't super hard, but if you can ultimate Nahiri, then you can just throw this out and swing 10, take third of their library off the top, you know? So that's crazy, right? I mean, why wouldn't you play Ulamog? We're playing 27 lands in the deck so that we can reliably hardcast this if we go late enough into the game. With the Necromantic Summons, we can get a 12-12 Ulamog. Pretty good. Again, you don't get the cast trigger, but you know. 12-12 Ulamog, indestructible, swings, kills them, you know. So, Ulamog, we absolutely have to play. And again, if you get this off a Sin Prodder, they're going to let you have it. But you can just discard it and then reanimate it again later. So just, yeah, Ulamog, the biggest, baddest dude in Standard right now. We have to make room for him in a Reanimator deck. He's the best reanimation target we can possibly dream of. Four Planeswalkers in the deck. We're playing three copies of Nahiri the Harbinger. This is a critical piece in the deck. Hello, Ziggy. I'm going to pick you up. I hope you don't mind. But this is a critical piece in the deck right here. The fact that you discard a card and then draw the card is good. You can discard, you know, big creatures and then reanimate them. That's the number one issue there. She also is defense, you know. This can just jump in on turn four and take out any tapped hangerback walkers without them busting. It can also just take out any creature that attacked you last turn that didn't have vigilance. So just good defense in and of itself, too. And when you do ultimate her, that's awesome. You can either go get a Goblin Dark Dwellers and, you know, go ahead and get some value out of it and then cast it again after it pops back to your hand. Or you can go get an Ulamog and just wreck face if that's what you want to do, which is probably what you want to do. You can also go get a Linvala if you want and gain some life, get back in the game, and then play it again the next turn. So that is also good. Just, yeah, Nahiri is absolutely the only reason that I would even want to build this deck. Like, as soon as I saw her, I was like, okay, Mardu Reanimator, let's make that work. Turns out it does, and she's a huge part of it. We're playing one copy of Chandra Flamecaller in the deck. Just does lots of stuff for us, you know. Can win the game all by herself off of her first ability. And can also wipe the board for us if that's what we need done a little bit later in the game. But that second ability is what we're worried about most, you know. If our hand is clogged up with a couple of big creatures, say we have an Ulamog and a Linvala, then we can go ahead and discard our hand into the graveyard and draw some cards and reanimate any big things that we did dump into the graveyard a little bit later. So just every ability on Sharnge is good. She can win the game by herself, great synergy with reanimation, and is board wipe. We're playing four enchantments in the deck before we move on to the spells. All four of them are Sinister Concoction, and this is a dream card for a Reanimator deck. In Reanimator, this is as cheap as it can possibly be, and it allows us to discard a big threat, and it increases the chance of getting a big threat off the top of our library, put it in the graveyard. Not only that, it also just destroys a creature. It just destroys a creature. That's sort of the number one aim of the card, is to kill a guy. And it does that really, really well. Unconditional removal for what is more or less one mana. You know, you play this turn one or two, and then you pop it, and next couple of turns. It can also sit there on the battlefield and sort of deter them from playing their best creatures, which is a great mind game, by the way, especially considering we're trying to get a little deep into the game. So really have loved Sinister Concoction, you know. And that's another thing, by the way, that we're taking damage off of. Just throwing that out there. So Linvala is better. You know, I forgot to mention that earlier when I was talking about the stuff that does damage to us. But mostly we're looking to dump a good creature in the graveyard and increase our chance of getting another big creature into the graveyard by flipping one over. So just Sinister Concoction is crazy. You know, just I started with two of these. Quickly went up to four. The card is bonkers. Two copies of Lightning Axe in the deck and a fairly flexible slot, but I have like Lightning Axe, you know, another discard outlet that for basically one mana every time is going to kill the biggest threat on their side of the board. Again, 90% of the time, I mean, most things are going to die to 5 damage. And it provides a discard outlet. We've got something like 12 discard outlets and Sin Prodder in the deck, so if you want to get rid of a big guy or Fuel Madness, then you've got plenty of ways to do it. We're only playing one card with Madness in the deck. But, you know, we have to, because we have so many discard outlets. But this has just been great, fantastic removal. And, you know, altogether, it might not look at first glance that we're playing a ton of removal, but we're playing something like 17 pieces that are capable of removing creatures, and in some cases, permanents. So that's a lot of removal and can help us get to the stage of the game we need to get to. And, you know, I'm not sure that Lightning Axe wouldn't be better served as a different card. I'm just not sure what the card is. And so far it's been great as just straight up kill that guy and discard outlet. We're playing four copies of Fiery Temper in the deck. That's the Madness card we're playing. This has just been really, really good. I mean, you know, like I said, 12 discard outlets in the deck. It's nice to have something to do other than discard creatures with that, you know. We can get some value out of it with Madness. That's great. And this is especially good with Lightning Axe, you know. Pitch this to Lightning Axe for 2 mana. You've basically killed a guy and done 3 damage to another target. You can often, do, you know, kill 2 guys for 2 mana that way. So, Fiery Temper's been great alongside other cards. It's another reason to play Lightning Axe, by the way. And just really good early protection, you know. It's even fine to play this for 3 mana. And sometimes, just burn them out when they're at 3, you know. So, been a good card for me, and I wouldn't remove this. You know, so many discard outlets, I feel like it's pretty important to play Fiery Temper. 2 Kolaghan's Command for all the obvious reasons. Just really, really good to recast this with the Goblin Dark Dwellers. It can kill a small guy. It can make them or us discard a card, which can sometimes be important. It can bust Hangerback Walkers and any equipments they venture to play. I don't know why they would. They're just throwing stuff out there. So Kolaghan's Command, just entirely too versatile not to play. It actually does more in this deck than it normally does because it can, we can discard a card if we want to with it, which we sometimes might, and do something else. And we can recast it with Dark Dwellers, so just Kolaghan's Command, absolute must. 1 copy of Anguished Unmaking in the main here, just because I want to have this sort of unconditional, you know, non-land permanent kind of removal. I'm not that worried about the 3, although, like I said, we are taking a fair amount of damage in the day. But I still think that it's worth playing this. 2 copies of Read the Bones in the deck for a couple of reasons. Some people would want to play Painful Truce in a 3-color deck, but we're playing Goblin Dark Dwellers, and it's not good to recast Painful Truce, but it's great to recast to Read the Bones. We're discarding a fair amount of cards due to some of the cards we're playing, so I like to have something that gives us a little bit of card advantage to kind of make up for it. Read the Bones, good call. And to finish off the spells, 4 copies of Necromantic Summons in the deck. This is your reanimation piece. Note that I'm not playing Ever After. I feel like it costs a lot, and yeah, we're getting up there and we're playing 27 lands, but we're only playing 10 creatures, so it's not going to be all the time you get all the value off of Ever After, even with all the discard outlets. I just feel like it's better to try and be as fast as possible, and 5 mana is as fast as we get in this format. This is also much more splashable than Ever After, and can make things huge, you know. It makes a Linvala a 7-7 flyer, makes Kolaghan, you know, an 8 power flyer. So Necromantic Summons has been great, and it's not hard to get spell mastery with, you know, basically, what is it, 15 spells in the deck, so, you know, instants and sorceries in the deck. Very easy to get it, and we can discard until we do have spell mastery. So, really, really, really great reanimation piece here. I think the best one we can play in the format. Here's the lands right here, and there's only a couple things I want to point out. 27 is a lot, but I want to hardcast Ulamog if it comes to it. And even if we're not hardcasting Ulamog, we still have to hardcast, you know, Dragonlord Kolaghan, Linvala sometimes, Chandra Flamecaller, so lots of lands is pretty much where we want to be. Altogether, deck has been really easy to get mana from, you know. It plays something like 18 or 19 black sources. Yeah, it's 18 black, 17 red, and like 14 white. We make plenty of all the mana we need to make. Here's the sideboard right here, and this is fairly tuned, you know. Duress against mostly control. We don't want to get, you know, counterspelled when we try to go and do stuff. But also good against, you know, any mass removal we don't want to see played, which sometimes is a thing. Or, you know, things like commands, stuff like that. So a bit of fine card, honestly. And Planeswalkers, by the way, gets Planeswalkers out of the hand, which we'll probably see a little bit more of. Duress has been important. I wouldn't mind putting it main deck. Ultimate Price has been great against aggro. You know, I feel like we get a little bit more mono-colored with the exit of Khans, you know. And yeah, we have Eldrazi in the format. Ultimate Price doesn't work against them. But that's why it's a great sideboard card against aggro. Mid-range decks that will play a lot of mono-colored creatures. So I do like Ultimate Price for the next few months here. Kozilek's Return is sort of our, you know, board sweeper against heavy aggro decks. And it's good because we are playing Ulamog, so there's a chance that we'll get another wipe off of it, which is always good. To the Slaughter has been pretty decent against mostly Ojutai, which is why it's in there in the first place. And sometimes it can wipe out an Ojutai and a Jace, which is absolutely crazy. Like, that is why To the Slaughter exists. And so if they have a Jace, Telepath Unbound, and Ojutai out, you can pretty much just wipe their board and make them cry. So To the Slaughter's been good out of the board. Very much so once you get the Delirium activated, which is not hard because we have discard outlets in the deck. You know, not hard. And then Infinite Obliteration is good against decks that also play Ulamog, and will get there a little bit faster than we will, definitely. Although we can reanimate an Ulamog on turn 5, and that's faster than those decks can play an Ulamog, but that doesn't happen every game. Virulent Plague against the Tokens decks that are pretty good at chump blocking us and are just jerks, and can go way wider than we can with our 10 creatures. 1 copy of Languish, just along with Kozilek's Return, another, you know, mass removal piece, which we need against these heavy aggro decks. We do fairly poorly against heavy aggro, so we need these sweepers out of the sideboard. And then two Hallowed Moonlight, because another card that does pretty well against us is Collected Company, especially with Reflector Mage running around. So it's very nice to have Hallowed Moonlight to counter those. Here are your power rankings for the deck. A final score of 68. That's a good score. We play a ton of powerful cards in the deck. And we have some pretty well-rounded stats. You know, we're not a very fast deck, but everything else, we do at least average or better, you know. Synergy is relatively high in a reanimator deck, especially like this. We've just got a lot of cards feed into one another. You know, Sin, Prodder, Goblin, Dark Dwellers, Nahiri, and pretty much everything else. Dark Dwellers and all the, you know, instants and sorcerers we're playing that cost 3. There's like 11. So lots of interesting synergies in the deck. Resiliency we're pretty good at because we're a reanimator deck, but we only play 4 reanimation spells, you know, so. But, resiliency is also good because we're playing a sweeper, main board, and Chandra. We're playing a ton of removal. That's good resiliency. And we're playing a ton of huge guys that can really change the game once they hit the board. So that's also resiliency. We got a high defense because of the 17 removal pieces. And then game 1, I think we do a little bit better than game 2 once they figured us out. We're fairly consistent. Just sometimes the reanimation strategy doesn't come together. But even if it doesn't, you've got a lot of big, splashy things to play. Total cost of the deck, as we're looking at it right about now, while we're still pre-ordering cards technically, is about $350, but that'll probably go down a smidge, you know, a hair. We'll have to see, depends on what the Shadow Duels, that's what I want to call them, Shadow Duels, Handlands. Depends on what they do price-wise, because they may fluctuate up or down, probably a dollar or two up in my estimation, but we'll have to see. But the deck cost about $350 in its current form, we'll have to see what happens with that. That's all I've got for now. Proxy this up, shuffle it up, and then if you've got the cards in a couple of weeks, take it up to your FNM, see how it does. I actually think this is a very strong deck in the upcoming format, and some form of this might be slightly important. I'm not totally sure, you know, I've said that before, and sometimes it pans out, sometimes it doesn't, but I really, really like the sort of gears of this deck, the guts of it, you know, sort of the things that make it up and the key cards in it, because there's definitely a shell that you're building around, you know, and we, you know, maybe an Eldritch Moon will get another crazy reanimation piece, so there's that. You can still build Solar Flare, which is white, blue, black reanimator. You know, that's still a possibility. So I think the reanimator has a lot of good things it can do, but this is the one that I would play at my FNM. I've had a lot of fun with it, and it's fairly versatile. You know, we don't just have to reanimate things. We've got other things we can do, and all of our cards are just crazy bombs past a certain point. So try it out. Let me know how you feel. Jun people that were expecting Junness, I hope that you stuck around for this long, because I'm going to give you a choice here. I'm working on 2 separate Jun decks, and I want to know which one you see first, and I've ruled out a double deck tech because these are both competitive, and I sort of want to give them both a spotlight. I could either play Jun mid-range that is mostly a good stuff deck, you know, we're playing Den Protector, we're playing Deathmist Raptor, Kalidas, and a bunch of other stuff, and, you know, just powerful cards on the mid-range. And then the other deck, that's Jund, is a Gitrog Monster and Mina and Din deck that plays like 30 lands and does like a bunch of huge stuff way up on the curve, you know. So let me know which one you want to see more, and I'll put that one out, because I think that they're both fine decks. I do love that Gitrog Monster deck, though. That's all I got for now. If you enjoyed the content, do me a favor, just click the thumbs up button. It takes a second, and it helps out the channel more than you could possibly understand. It really helps out a lot. Share the video if you're into it. I mean, you know, if you want to. You can also comment, because I want to know how you felt about this and any upcoming decks we're doing. And then sub if you're new, if you've never seen me before, if you've seen me a bunch of times you haven't subbed, it's probably time. I'm Dev from SBMTG. Thanks for watching, my wizards.